Thank you, Piramal Art Foundation. It's really lovely to be here. And ever since I was invited to come and speak about Manida K.G.Subramanyan's work on printmaking, I have learned so much about him, which I really didn't know before. I'm very glad also to be among such an interesting set of speakers whose work I admire and whom I admire as people as well. So I'll be quite short. My presentation is largely visual, but what I have done is, in this process of learning more about his work, I have sort of taken in the words of several different people, who are my colleagues, people who have just told me about their experience of him. So everything is not from a book or from some kind of printed record, but more a very evocative, I think, warm mode of remembering him that came directly from people. So that's more of what you'll see. I'm beginning with this wonderful lithograph, which is done in a very special medium called tush. And this particular medium is really, really difficult to handle. Anyone who is a printmaker here will know. It's like trying to print watercolor on a lithography stone. And when you see this image, it embodies, I think, so much of what he absorbed from life around him, from history, from mythology, from oral folklore that was existing around him, not only as forms of art and craft, but also from literature, which he very strongly absorbed. So I just put in here some of his own words, which will give you a sense of the kind of elements that he took in. These images certainly have their origins in common scenes observed in a town or village. The vision of an able-bodied woman in a Jat village trying to control a runaway buffalo calf, or a wiry Bengali villager doing the same, though with more physical skill than strength, give you two images of Durga. So he continuously connected myth, history, real life, urban life, rural life through his imagery. Now, as a printmaker, of course, I was asked to look at his works on printmaking. But I must say here that with Manida, I think that the medium really didn't matter. His fluid sense of, his creativity actually just flowed through every single thing that he touched. Whether it was terracotta murals, whether they were paintings, whether printmaking, stuffed toys, dolls, woven works, and, even artwork made from scrap material, which is often what happened at the Nandan Mela. He really was able to transform his imagery in such a powerful way that here I would stand to say that it's not the printmaking here that is attracting me to this work, but it's his lines and it's his forms. These particular works are from the Vazvo X Vazvo collection of Indian printmaking that I had the opportunity to curate over from 2011 to 2013 at the National Gallery of Modern Art. And Durga, of course, was my favorite work. So here, like I said, I have these little quotes from various people who felt strongly about Manida's work. And of course, K.G. Subramanyan's The Living Tradition Perspectives on Modern Indian Art, I think is really one of the most scholarly and I think also very factual understandings of art at his time. An incredibly brilliant mind. That's what I really think that he must have been. I unfortunately did not have too much of direct contact with him, except for on a couple of occasions. But having studied in Bangalore and having seen the Kala Mela, which was very much inspired by the kinds of thoughts he had about the intermingling of all forms of art, what we call high and low art, he did not have those hierarchies at all. He considered everything in its own place. This is from the Asia Art Archives, and it's from Jyoti Bhatt's personal records of MS University Baroda, the printmaking department. That's K.G. Subramanyan, just a couple of years ago, working on a litho stone in Shantiniketan. Special thanks to Arpan Mukherjee for the images. He passed away at 92, but I think that the youth in his mind and heart remained always. These are some of his very early works. I have tried to put together largely only his printmaking works, many of them which are not really seen. To a large extent, he worked with painting in the last couple of decades, but also a lot of screen printing, and lithography was one of his favorite mediums. Being a plain surface, I think that it was one of the mediums that allowed him to draw very freely, just like on paper, or I think the surface didn't matter. Ultimately, when he drew on a large wall also, he brought about the same kind of magic. So these are a few very early works of his from the 50s, from the 70s. Many of them were shown at the retrospective exhibition that was curated by Sivakumar at the National Gallery of Modern Art in 2003. Along with it, it had a wonderful book that that contains, I think, quite a treasure of records of his work through his life. He worked in a prolific manner. I think that such large bodies of work one does not find in young artists nowadays. I do not want to make that like a general statement, but in my experience as a teacher and as someone who runs modules with students, really, it's hard to find the kind of bodies of work that these masters really had. So this is a small quote from Between the Lines. He really worked with every medium without any restriction. And he was able to inculcate this kind of broad understanding of modernity in his students. Large numbers of students in Baroda, in Shantiniketan, and I think everywhere, not only those whom he taught directly, but like Baishali said, a lot who have also learned through reading his works, learned through looking at his paintings and drawings and prints. It's just quite a vast number that he has touched. I'm sure not only in India, but elsewhere. So the one point I would like to touch upon with printmaking is that it's a medium it's possible to engage in a very social way. Firstly, because it can be made in editions, which is in several numbers, and it can be distributed. We do consider even now in the market that prints are less expensive than paintings, because for some reason the uniqueness of a painting causes it to be priced at a higher rate than, let's say, a print that has 8 editions or 25 editions. At a platform like the Nandan Mela, prints were made in large numbers by artists, and everyone has had access to it. You can go up and buy something for 10 rupees, 20 rupees, 50 rupees, 100 rupees. It's vast. Here I'd like to read out this particular statement by K.S. Radhakrishnan close associate of Siv Kumar and student at one point of time of Manida. Students would surround him wanting to get a good look at how he worked. He would ask the students to help him. One print would be made. If he was not satisfied, he would make a slight change and a new print would be made. We would be charged with excitement. I can just imagine the situation because it is exciting like that. To see someone's sheet of, you know, a paper, printed paper being taken off from an etching plate or from a lithograph stone is one of the most exciting things. And to watch him working, I think, must have been very special. This is just some, you know, snapshots of the Nandan Mela, a sort of open platform where people from all around come and participate in a very strong cultural, culturally resonating festival, which is celebrated as the birth centenary of Nandlal Bose. I'll speak a little bit about his silk screens because it was something that really interested him. As you can see, the black and white was extremely suitable to his kind of expression. They are stark, bold lines which are very free and they simply just take the space. You don't need a perspectival drawing behind it. You don't need some kind of realistic, sort of framework within which to see these images because they are so powerful in themselves. Again, an earlier silk screen, 1993. So this, I think, is, again, remembering what Baishali said in the beginning of her talk, and which connected very much with what he said in his letter, which certainly is that in our college fine art syllabi, I think we should have the space for master craftspeople and people who are working outside the academic fine art system. My works have always sought to move between the real and the imaginary. True, what we call real is itself an image of a kind, which is so true. My main interest was once in the passage of the objective to the abstract. Abstract to mean here an image of relative anonymity, which allowed it a variety of interpretations, gave it the ability to play various visual roles. Now the cross connections I'm interested in are more complicated. The images are more than visual. They have a complex identity, diverse cultural associations, and background lore. This was from a dialogue he had in 2014. Some of his color serigraphs, these were largely, to a certain extent, he worked with Archer Art Gallery in Ahmedabad. And here's what Anil Relia, founder of Archer Art Gallery, had to say. When he spoke, he said that really Manita was a stickler for every fine technical aspect that was required from a serigraph. And it was not that he'd made a drawing and passed it on and said, okay, produce my prints, but he would take part in every single process that went through in producing his prints. Books. Now, this is something that he took a large amount of interest in. And in terms of printmaking and the use of serigraphy or silk screen printing, this becomes a very interesting space to look at his work. He was able to associate the word with the image in a most fluid manner. And I think that his mind was like that. It created words where there were visuals and it created visuals where there were words. And for us, they come together. For children, I think that it's a most joyful experience. So to quickly go through some beautiful images, these prints were made at the department at MS University Baroda and shared by Debraj Goswami. Simple, sharp, and storytelling. enjoyable. So we have again here Debraj who speaks about what he found interesting about the black and white aspect of Manida's work, and how as an artist and a teacher himself, he understood how an Indian identity could come into work that was extremely modernistic. When God first made the animals, he made them all alike. Really beautiful. He continually simplified and made things complex. If that's a paradox, then that's what he did. He also had a very thriving and good relationship and friendship with his peers, with other people who were working around him. I think perhaps that he was not judgmental, and that is why he was able to expand his understanding of others' works, not only those who were his contemporaries, but also students. He constantly gave space to students to speak to him, to expand their horizons through him. And it was not a rigid relationship, but rather something that grew continuously. So many of his students have wonderful little postcards, just like Baishali said, sent by him with little drawings on them, just to show that he cared and that he remembered that there were people who were also in this space that he was occupying, in this space and time. Here at Shantiniketan, and you see also K.S. Radhakrishnan and always willing to attend programs, always willing to make his presence felt in a quiet, humble and optimistic way. My only three meetings with him, that was something that came across very strongly. I am by nature a fabulist. I transform images, change their character, make them float, fly, perform, tell a visual story. To that extent, my pictures are playful and spontaneous. I do occasionally build round a well-known theme and give it new implications. He was very clear that he was not an activist artist, but the other way around, an artist activist. He didn't take social issues and make them the headlines of his work, but it did not mean that he did not address them in some way. He addressed them in his own method of filtering it through his stylistic visual language, as well as through the entire range of knowledge that I think he collected over several decades of his practice. To come to the end, this, of course, our Shiv Kumar, who is one of the most important, let's say, biographers of Manida's work, interviewed him extensively, spent lots of time with him, and also had a number of exhibitions of his work. So he says, indeed, he's very versatile. On this count, he's like Picasso and Matisse among the early moderns, and like Hockney among those who are closer to him in age. But his versatility came from his mentors in Shantiniketan, which is something that we can't forget. Nandlal Bose, Vinod Bihari Mukherjee and Ram Kinkar Bej were his teachers, and we don't have them anymore. Through their pedagogy and example, they taught him to value versatility over narrow individualism associated with modernism. He imbibed from them a vision of art as both communication and creative innovation. And later, as he tried to put it into practice, he discovered that the two were mutually enriching rather than excluding. I think that is something that we constantly have to remind ourselves of in this day. So to finish, just some thoughts from a few people who have learned from him. his creativity really splurged into all venues. And again, in K.S. Radhakrishnan's words, his presence will really be felt very strongly. But of course, he remains with us through his stories, through his drawings, and through his prints. Thank you.